This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes how to use return on investment to evaluate an investment center. And an investment center, this is described in a separate video, an investment center is a division or subunit or segment that controls investment in long-term assets, profit, and costs. So what we're trying to talk about or trying to do here is to evaluate an investment center and use the return on investment, ROI, to evaluate an investment center. So return on investment, the formula is right here. The return on investment is operating income divided by average operating assets. Operating income is in the numerator, so here's some key points having to do with operating income. It's in the numerator, and it includes income that's produced by the division from its daily operating activities. So it's the income that's produced from the day-to-day operations of the business, not unusual outside things like the gain on if there's an investment somewhere in some other company, a gain on that. No, that's not included in here. We're talking about income produced by the division from its daily operations. And it often excludes items such as income tax expense, interest income, interest expense, and any other unusual, as I just mentioned, gains or losses. So we exclude those items and just want to include the items that come from daily operations. And then in the denominator, we're looking at average operating assets. And what we're talking about here are the assets that the division has in place that are needed to run the daily operations of the business. So again, we're not talking about, for example, investments in other companies that would be considered an asset. We're really just talking about the assets that are in place within our own company that are used in the daily operations of the business. So for example, if I'm Home Depot, I have forklifts within my stores. That's a long-term asset. That long-term asset is used in the daily operations of the business. And then the second bullet point here, we calculate it by adding simply the beginning period asset balances and the ending period balances, and then just divide by two. So that then gives us the average for that period. So what's the advantage of using ROI as a performance measure? Well, it includes the segment's use of assets, and that's really important. If we're looking at several different segments or divisions of our business and the profits that each segment generates, then we want to look at those profits relative to assets, not just the profits alone. What kind of assets were required to produce those profits? Another way to put it is, how effectively did each division make use of the operating assets that are there? So that's where return on investment really helps us to evaluate that. Here's a simple example to kind of help reinforce that concept. Let's say that we have two different divisions, and each division has the exact same operating profit, but different operating assets. So let's assume, first bullet point here, that two different divisions each generated exactly $10,000 in operating income for the year. We can't just simply say, great, they're exactly the same, those divisions performed identically. We have to look at the assets that were required to generate that profit. So then I'm going to give you some more information in the second bullet point. Let's assume that Division 1 had average operating assets of $200,000, and Division 2 had average operating assets of $400,000. Well, now it's an entirely different picture, because Division 1 only required $200,000 in assets to generate $10,000 in profit, whereas Division 2 required $400,000 in operating assets, average operating assets, to generate the same amount of income. Another way to look at it is to actually calculate return on investment, and then this helps us to level the playing field by looking at the income relative to the assets required to produce that income. And if you look at these calculations, you'll see that for Division 1, they had a return on investment of 5%. That's the $10,000 divided by the $200,000. And then Division 2 had a return on investment of half that, of 2.5%, because they required double the assets to generate the same amount of income. And therefore, Division 1 has the higher ROI than Division 2. And that's just one example of how return on investment is helpful in evaluating two different divisions with exactly the same results here in terms of operating income. Okay, so let's formalize this a little bit. I've got several videos that use this same company and the same exact information, so you can look at this across the different videos and start to compare these different ways to different measures to use to evaluate investment centers. Our company is Game Products, Inc., And we have three different divisions, and everything you see here is for the fiscal year ended December 31. We have three different divisions. We have the sporting goods division, we have the board games division, and we have the computer games division. Each division is autonomous. Each division has its own manager. And so now what we're doing is evaluating how each division is doing because they're investment centers. They control long-term assets for each division. They control, they're responsible, I should say, for profits and for costs as well. So we're looking at investment centers here and evaluating each investment center using return on investment. So remember from the previous slides that the return on investment is calculated by taking our operating income, that's right here, operating income, and dividing it by average operating assets. We've already talked about what goes into each of those, and you can look at the bullet, or rather the footnotes at the very bottom of this slide to get a better sense of the details of what went into getting those numbers, but we have talked about them. So we take operating income divided by average operating assets, and that then gives us return on investment, or what we often call ROI. And you'll see here that the sporting goods division had, these are all in thousands, $3,295,000 in operating income and $29,350,000 in the average operating assets. So we take one divided by the other, and that tells us that the sporting goods division had an ROI, return on investment, of 11.23%. Another way to put it is for every $100 that the sporting goods division had in average operating assets, they generated about $11 and some change in operating income. I'll say it again. For every $100 in average operating assets, the sporting goods division generated about $11.23 in operating income. So that gives you an idea of how to calculate return on investment and then what it means. And you can then compare that to the other divisions within this company, and you'll notice that the board games division had an ROI of 8.93%, and the computer games division had an ROI of 6.75%. And as a result, we can draw the conclusion that the sporting goods division had the highest ROI, return on investment, and therefore you could make the conclusion they made the best use of their average operating assets for the year ended December 31. There are some issues that are associated with using return on investment as a performance measure. And really what it comes down to as I go through these is we have to decide as a company how we want to calculate our operating income and our average operating assets because it's not always clear cut. And then we want to be consistent with all of our divisions all across the board over time. So the first bullet point here, you'll see that there are several variations of operating income. And there are just two examples here. Some companies use, exclude allocated overhead. In other words, companies will often allocate overhead to each division, but some companies then will exclude that overhead amount in the numerator, in the operating income amount. And then some companies will include income tax expense. They feel that it's appropriate to include that for each division. So again, it's up to the company to decide, and these are just two examples, there are many more, to decide how to calculate operating income, and it's really important to be consistent and to communicate that to the managers within each division. And then there are also several variations on average operating assets, which goes in the denominator. Some companies will use net book value for long-term assets, which simply means the cost of the long-term asset minus the accumulated depreciation. Other companies may decide to use simply the gross book value, which just means the cost of the long-term asset without subtracting accumulated depreciation. And then that starts to cause some issues, depending on which approach is used, with some divisions that have fully depreciated assets, meaning old assets, versus other divisions that have relatively new assets. That starts to distort then the results. So these are the types of issues that crop up and we have to consider as a company, and again, make sure that we're consistent across the board with all of our divisions. I should also note that the return on investment can be broken down into two separate measures, which can be useful for management to look at those two separate measures. The two separate measures are operating profit margin, this number here, and asset turnover. And if we find the operating profit margin as defined below, and we multiply that by asset turnover, we get return on investment. And it's the same number as we talked about before, but we're just breaking it out into a few more details, and it gives us some other measures that we can use to do a further evaluation on how each division is performing. So I'm going to do this fairly quickly. The operating profit margin, second bullet point, is calculated by taking the operating income and dividing that by sales. And it provides information about how much operating profit is being produced for each dollar of sales. And then asset turnover is calculated by taking the sales divided by average operating assets. And remember that our return on investment was calculated by simply taking the operating income and dividing by the average operating assets. So here we're introducing sales into the equation and doing some further analysis. So the asset turnover at the very bottom provides information about how much revenue each dollar invested in average operating asset produces. And that's useful information for management. Here's an example for Game Products Inc. using the same information that we saw before, but breaking it out into the two different measures that lead into return on investment. We have the operating profit margin here, and you can see that that has, I already gave you the formula on the previous slide. You'll see that that is 16.48% for the sporting goods division, and that is higher than the other two divisions, operating profit margin is. So they're performing the best, sporting goods division is, in that area. And then we have the asset turnover ratio, and you'll see that that is 0.68 for the sporting goods division, and it's 0.61 for the board games division, and 0.87 for the computer games division. So the computer games division is doing the best in this area in terms of the sales that are generated from the average operating assets that are in place. And then lastly, we can use those two measures and multiply operating profit margin times the asset turnover to get the return on investment. And you'll see for the board, or rather the sporting goods division, that that is 16.48% times 0.68, and that gives us a return on investment of 11.21%. And that looks like it's the highest between the three divisions. So they're performing the best overall in terms of return on investment.